Okay, I hope everyone managed to grab a seat. We have a full house tonight. Welcome to the 45th round of the Cairo Climate Talks, COP22, Fostering Climate Change Resilience in Egypt. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. So as all of you are aware, you're all aware that the Paris Agreement, which is the outcome of two intense weeks of international climate negotiations, paved the way for global action against climate change, irreversible disruptions to our climate. It sets the clear target of limiting average global temperatures to well below 2 degrees by the end of the century, which is the scientifically agreed upon threshold beyond which irremediable damage would be caused. The Paris Agreement officially entered into force in November 2016 after 55 countries responsible for 55% of all greenhouse gas emissions ratified it. Today, we have 125 parties that have ratified the Paris Agreement out of 197. And the swiftness with which the agreement came into force came as a surprise to most. But COP21 also opened the way to many years of negotiations ahead to fine-tune and clarify many details in order to enable countries to arm themselves with strong policies which ultimately would translate into effective action of mitigation and adaptation on the ground. For those of you who are not familiar with the climate negotiation jargon, mitigation refers to actions taken to decrease greenhouse gas emissions, particularly CO2, and adaptation focuses on lowering the risks posed by the consequences of climate change. So, for example, just to give you a contextually relevant example, Egypt's adaptation to sea level rise could translate into the construction of sea defenses to slow down the seawater incursions into the delta. So before turning to the main outcomes of COP22, which is why we're here tonight, let me just point out some significant points of contention. In the run-up to COP21 in Paris, developed and developing countries were asked to present their nationally determined contributions, a document which highlighted each country's roadmap to tackle climate change in the years and decades to come. Experts tasked with aggregating those documents found that these contributions would lead us to an average global temperature rise comprised between 2.7 and 3.5 degrees, which obviously is far from the Paris Agreement targets of 2 degrees. What it means, concretely, is that all countries will have to increase their ambition in the following years to combat climate change and maintain us within an acceptable 2-degree limit. Another crucial point of the negotiations revolved around climate finance, obviously, and whether developed countries will honor their pledges to provide $100 billion a year to developing countries to help them combat climate change's impact locally. So our experts today will provide us with more information on this issue and also on how countries can access this finance. But let's quickly go back to Marrakech and what the major outcomes of COP22 were. First of all, the conference adopted a call for all nations to honor promises made in Paris and renew their attempt to keep disaster at bay. Although this document contains little new information, it was deemed absolutely necessary by observers, especially in light of the election of Donald Trump as President of the United States, who is a fierce climate change denier. During COP22, no less than 11 new governments ratified the Paris Agreement. Among those, there were Australia, Botswana, Burkina Faso, the UK, Japan, and Italy. Since voluntary national emission targets are insufficient to meet the 2-degree goal, Marrakech has focused on initiatives meant to reinforce existing plans. As a result, some countries have promised to raise the level of ambition by 2020. And the fourth important outcome of COP22 was the creation of a coalition of 47 developing countries to lead the global green transition with the ambition to ultimately go 100% renewable. So before I start asking tricky questions to our panelists here, I would like to call His Excellency Julius Georg Loy to come to the stage and give his opening remarks. Thank you very much.
Ambassador Abuel Magt, Deputy Assistant Minister for Foreign Affairs for Environment and Sustainable Development, representatives of ministries and embassies, panelists, ladies and gentlemen, and last but certainly not least, our core audience here, the dear Cairo Climate Talkers. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the 45th Cairo Climate Talks panel discussion, the very first in 2017. I wish you and our climate all the best for this year. 2017 is a special year for German-Egyptian science cooperation since it marks the 10th anniversary of the German-Egyptian science year of 2007. That year paved the way for several bilateral agreements promoting the exchange of students and researchers, as well as joint research projects between both our countries. Of course, German-Egyptian science cooperation dates back much longer than this, and the embassy is looking forward to another productive German-Egyptian science decade. The Cairo Climate Talks, as a series of monthly events, are a great example of our trustful partnership. They were launched in 2011 by the German Embassy Cairo in close cooperation with the Ministry of Environment and several German organizations, among them the DRD, the German Academic Exchange Service, and the GIZ. Tonight's CCT focuses on the outcomes of the recent 22nd session of the Conference of the Parties in Marrakech. The COP22 is also referred to as the Action and Implementation COP, as it took place only, as was mentioned already, only a few days after the Paris Agreement had entered into force, and thus was thought to explore how the agreement could be put into practice. Accordingly, questions of mitigation and adaptation, financing, transparency, and capacity building were being discussed. Germany and Egypt both took on an active role at the COP22. As first country to present a long-term strategy, Germany introduced its Climate Action Plan 2050, which was taken with great interest. The action plan formulates mission statements for 2050 for systematically decarbonizing all key areas: energy, buildings, transport, industry, commerce, trade and services, agriculture, forestry and waste management, and develop milestones and operative measures for the crucial 2030 landmark. Besides, Germany announced the launch of the Global NDC Partnership, which had been put forward by our Ministry for the Environment as well as our Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development. The Global NDC Partnership aims to support developing and industrializing countries financially and through know-how with implementing their national climate contributions. Egypt, for its part, successfully launched phase two of the Africa Adaptation Initiative and made important progress in bringing the Africa Renewable Energy Initiative forward. Congratulations. The Paris Agreement, entering into force less than 1 year after being adopted at the COP21 highlights the importance given to climate change adaptation and mitigation by country leaders all over the world. As has been mentioned, to this day, 125 parties of 197 parties altogether to the convention have ratified the agreement. Together, they account for more than 80% of the total global greenhouse gas emissions. We are confident that our Egyptian partners follow their ratification process with some emphasis. Like any other international agreement, the convention can only be effective if it builds on strong and coherent national climate policies. However, climate change does not stop at national borders, and neither should our actions. In Paris, country leaders have shown that they are willing to join forces. In Marrakech, they have reaffirmed their commitment, notwithstanding the recent developments in the US already addressed. Now it is a common responsibility of politics, business, and civil society to make sure that the agreement does not remain a mere lip service. Ladies and gentlemen, climate change is one of the most severe challenges our world is facing today. the global average temperature has already increased by approximately 1%, degree Celsius compared with the pre-industrial level. Egypt and the other countries in the region will be among the most affected by global warming. But climate change has entered, for example, Germany too. The number of hot days with peak daily temperatures of 30 degrees or higher has increased significantly since the 70s. What might sound normal for most of you here in this room is indeed a serious development in countries which have not really become used yet to be surrounded by the desert or to sustain extreme heat waves or biblical heavy rainfalls and inundations. At tonight's CCT, political and economic decision makers, policy consultants, scientists, and civil society representatives will introduce their ideas for climate change adaptation and mitigation strategies in general and explore possible scenarios for Egypt in particular. I'm pleased that they are with us tonight, and I'm looking forward to an informative evening, an evening with vivid and, I hope, multi-layered, engaged discussions about a development which will shape, for a long time even measured in Earth history, basic living conditions of humanity and nature as a whole. Thank you very much.
So let me take you quickly and tell you how things are going to go. You are in the process of being given a sticky note, yellow post-it. So on this yellow post-it, in a little while, you'll be able to write your questions, and some of my colleagues will go around and just collect them from you so we can have some of your questions asked. I also wanted to let you know that Egypt's Minister of Environment, Dr. Khaled Fahmy, is on his way. He shall arrive shortly, so we will start, and once he arrives, he will give his opening remarks. Okay, so now it's my pleasure to introduce you to our panelists tonight. So first, hold on. Our first panelist tonight is Ambassador Wael Aboulmegd, who is the Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs for Environment and Sustainable Development. So Ambassador Wael is part of the Egyptian team of negotiators, and it will take us through the complex negotiation processes tonight, as well as highlight Egypt's position regarding climate change. Welcome, Dr. Wael. Then I would like to introduce our second panelist, who is Dr. Maged Mahmoud, who is the Technical Director of the Regional Center for Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency, RECRE, based here in Cairo. Dr. Maged has 20 years of experience in leading renewable energy projects across the Middle East and North Africa. With his acute knowledge of energy policies across the region, he will clarify how renewable energy can take us faster on the path of sustainable development. Welcome, Dr. Maged. Then I'm moving on to our following panelist, Mahmoud Rifai. Mahmoud is currently a project manager at Siemens Power Generation Services Division. He's also one of the author of the acclaimed 80 gigawatt of change report, which highlights 7 pathways for Egypt's electricity development and looks into the many benefits brought by increasing the share of renewable energy in Egypt's electricity mix. Welcome. Then I would like to introduce you to Hoda Baraka. Hoda is an Egyptian environmentalist and the global communications director for the 350.org campaign. But over the years, she has worked as an environmental journalist for local and international news outlets, as a photographer, an activist, a consultant, and a teaching assistant at the American University in Cairo. So her presence tonight will give us a better understanding of the role played by environmental NGOs globally in climate negotiations. And finally, I would like to introduce you to Lena Donat, who came all the way from Berlin to be with us today. Lena is a fellow at the Berlin-based Ecologic Institute. She specializes in international environmental law and climate change, and she will help us understand the significance of the Paris Agreement and how it can be translated into important policies and actions on the ground. So welcome to all of you. Thank you for being with us. My first question goes to you, Ambassador Wael. Egypt has signed the Paris Agreement in New York in April 2016, but still hasn't ratified it. When can we expect the ratification to take place, and what explains this delay? And the second part of my question is, could you then define Egypt's role in the climate negotiations, since Egypt negotiates as part of three different groups, the G77 plus China, the Arab group, and the African group? So what does it mean in terms of, you know, challenges, but also opportunities?
Thank you very much. Before I get to answering your question, I would just want to express a few words of gratitude, appreciation to Ambassador Loyen, the German Embassy, to the Egyptian Ministry of Environment for their initiative in regularly organizing this type of event. To us at the Foreign Ministry, it is of immense value. I confess this is my first participation in this event, but I look forward to continuously taking part. It's an opportunity for us at the Foreign Ministry to reach out, to share whatever experiences or developments are taking place on the international negotiation front on climate, but also, and I think even more importantly, is to listen to others, practitioners like the distinguished panelists here, but also people, activists, advocacy groups, environmentalists from Egypt and beyond. So thank you very much for organizing this event and for including us in on this panel. The short answer to your question regarding ratification, we started the process of ratification quite a while back. It's the nature of things in Egypt that you get a turn in Parliament to have your paperwork to process. But we've gone through the governmental side, the executive branch side. It's been through all of the processing with the Ministry of Environment as the parent organization responsible for it. And then it came to our legal department, where we have a particular committee that all treaties, all international treaties, has to go through with all government entities represented. I don't want to encumber you with all the details of the procedure, but there's no political issue pertaining to this. It's just a matter of it taking time. And in fact, this takes me to one of the first or most important procedural issues that we had to contend with there in Marrakech, which was, as you rightly said in your introductory remarks, everyone was taken aback or almost surprised at the pace of ratifications and the early, everybody used the term early entry into force. No one in Paris anticipated that by the next COP that people were questioning the very fact that it would enter into force by then, let alone to have, I think in November we had about 100 ratifications already, meeting the double threshold you alluded to. So at the end of the day, it is not unnatural. In fact, the whole process, when we were there on the procedural side, made sure to accommodate countries that had not, for any fault of theirs, not been part of the ratification process. So there was a decision taken that the CMA1, which is the body entrusted to implement Paris and take it forward and take decisions, would not become operational until 2018, to allow sufficient time for everyone to come on board, because the whole idea is to have a collective decision-making, an inclusive decision-making process. You asked a very broad question about Egypt's role in the negotiations, and I'll come back to some of really the main points that I want to share with the audience in one of my future questions that you direct to me. But right now you mentioned this change in the number of groups that Egypt is part of, and that would be one of the first and foremost trends that I would detect. I've been involved in international negotiations within the multilateral system in the UN for many, many years. This is very different. You always had your traditional fault line of developing versus developed, where shared interests were existent in these two general broad groups. You mentioned the G77 and China. It would be very fair to say that there is a wide, wide variety of opinions and views and interests within the G77 and China. So we had to break down, and Egypt was represented and actively participating in, of course, the G77 and China as the major umbrella for most developing countries, but also in the Arab group, in the African group, and also in something not everyone was familiar with, and I wasn't familiar with until I really actively joined this process, which is called the like-minded developing countries. Because within the developing countries, you have least developed countries, LDCs. You have within developing countries the small island states, developing states. Their interests and their priorities and their urgency of action is very different than China or Saudi Arabia or Egypt, for that matter. So what was more efficient, in a sense, to break into these subgroups. Everyone, of course, is there on equal footing, but it helped the process move forward to have these multiplicity of coalitions of groups that share common positions in order to be represented. But it was very common practice to hear the floor given not to individual countries, but someone speaking on behalf of the LDCs. And at the same time, someone speaking on behalf of the African group, whereas many LDCs are already African group members. So it may seem a bit confusing. I hope I didn't confuse everybody with all this. But it is one of the main trends and features that you don't have your traditional fault lines of developing agreeing on everything and developed countries agreeing on everything, and we're just getting together to bridge the gap in perceptions, because it is a very complex issue, and there's so many sides to it, and that's how we conducted it. As to our contribution, we hope that we contributed constructively. We have our misgivings, we have our concerns, we make them very well known, but that has no bearing on how actively and constructively we hope to continue. We have in the past, and we will continue to contribute to the negotiations. I have to show off my team of negotiators here. I headed the negotiating team, but three of our negotiating team happen to be present from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and from the Ministry of Environment, and they are top-notch negotiators on the issues. And we had to break down. Nobody can do everything at the COP. It would be ridiculous. Every delegation has people exclusively for finance issues, others for mostly the mitigation aspect, the adaptation aspect, the legal procedural sides of it. It is a very, very complex web of issues, and it would be delusional to think that a small delegation could be able to cover it. So our delegation, this is just a small fraction of the number of people who participated, obviously. We did our best, we contributed, we continue to contribute, and again, as I said, and I'll come back to some of the misgivings, but we intend to approach this in a very constructive manner in the future as well.
And do you mind me asking if we have a schedule for the ratification? Will it happen this year?
It's very difficult to predict very precise dates when it comes to members of parliament. Parliament in itself has its own schedule. Our role is almost complete. I think it has been completed on the executive branch side. Once it's in the hands of parliament, just from past experiences, I can't expect that they would have any serious issues with it at all, because our experience with multilateral treaties that have been negotiated, they usually go through smoothly unless there's something very flagrant in it, which is definitely not the case here, as has been our argument and that of the Ministry of Environment. So, but let me just reiterate, it really has no bearing. We will ratify, we want to ratify, but the process is going forward, taking into consideration that many countries just need some more time to complete their process. So there's no political implication and not even any practical implication as to our ability to participate. No decisions will be taken by the CMA1 for the time being. There are other venues and fora and working groups that will take decisions, but everything has been postponed. In 2017, we'll just come back for a quick, hopefully quick, stock-taking process to see any developments and progress that's been made over the past year. But 2018, that's the deadline whereby everyone, whoever hasn't completed their process by then, they'll still participate, but they will not be part of the decision-making. Decision-making is not a serious problem there. Okay. Everything is by consensus, more or less, thank God.
Thank you. Just for those of you, again, who are not so familiar with the jargon of what stock-taking is, maybe we can just be careful to explain those terms. So there should be ratcheting up and an increase of the ambition of the nationally determined contributions that will happen this year and then hopefully in the future. So you just want to explain what it is for you.
But I need to jump in here.
Yes.
The stock taking I refer to should not be confused with the one you're alluding to, which is the global stock take process, okay, which is an integral part of the agreement. So what I was talking about, I even suggested there, let's find a different word than stock taking, lest we confuse it with the global stock take. Global stock take is the process whereby we'll get together and see how we're collectively moving as opposed to the national movement. But the one I'm referring to, when we come back to 2017, please, let's just call it something else, taking note of progress made or something. That's what's happening in 2007, but thanks for that.
Okay. Elena, I did mention in my introduction a few of the outcomes of COP22 in Marrakech, but could you elaborate and tell us a little bit which ones you believed are the most crucial for developing countries and Egypt?
Yes, thank you very much. Well, I think on the formal side of the outcomes of the COP, the most important one sounds maybe vague to people who are not in the negotiations, which is the roadmap for how negotiations on the Paris Agreement will take place over the next years. So, as many of you may know, the Paris Agreement was a global deal. Many countries came together, 196 parties agreed on something, and of course, as it's always with compromises, the content of the compromise is not always very clear, but left vague in many instances to get everyone on board for the final decision. Which means that many of the details are not written in the Paris Agreement yet. Many issues have been left open. So to actually be able to implement the Paris Agreement, we still need to agree on many, many of the detailed rules on, for example, how to measure emissions over in your inventories, how to present certain reports, for example, adaptation plans, or what the NDCs should contain, or how the global stocktake that was already alluded to should actually look like in detail. So all these rules still need to be decided. And in Marrakech, it was now agreed that this rule book should be finalized by 2018. So that's 2 years from now, so it gives us some time to find agreement on these issues, and I think it's very important to have this deadline to make sure that countries finalize these negotiations on time. But I think what is much more important of this COP in Marrakech is the political momentum around it, because the negotiations to the Paris Agreement that led to the Paris Agreement, there were so many stakeholders getting on board, so many countries showing support for the negotiations, and only because of this also a very high level support of heads of states arriving at Paris and showing their support for climate action. Only all these stakeholders together made Paris possible. And the fear was that after Paris, the attention for climate change would drop very quickly. So now we have an agreement, okay, we can move on, and everyone does business as usual as before. What I think what is very important about the COP in Marrakech is that parties and the countries and all stakeholders show that they still stand behind Paris. That the ratification went very quickly in many countries. They, for example, in Germany, went much quicker than they actually had thought of before. Like normally also in Germany, it takes 2-3 years to finalize ratification. But this time they said, okay, you know, we do it really earlier because we want to get it done and we want to show that we stand behind Paris. There were so many initiatives launched in Marrakech as well, like the NDC partnership that was mentioned, or a 2050 platform for 2050 strategies. Many, many other initiatives that show that stakeholders, not only at state level, but also non-state actors, stand behind the Paris Agreement. I think this is actually the more important outcome, especially also if you see where the US is heading at the moment. And having the elections in the US happening right at the same time as the COP in Marrakech, but still countries standing up and say, anyway, like China standing up, the EU standing up, many developing countries standing up and saying, we still stand behind Paris. Thank you.
Including American states as well.
Yeah.
This exactly. Was pretty clear. That was an interesting development. I remember while being there, the terror that befell upon us when Donald Trump was elected, and then people picked up and actually came up with really ambitious targets after that. So that was interesting. Dr. Maggot, at COP21, African countries led by Egypt announced the creation of the launch of the African Renewable Energy Initiative, which plans to add 10 gigawatts of electricity to the continent by 2020 and an additional 300 gigawatts by 2030. So do you believe that this initiative has the potential of considerably boosting renewable energy investments in Africa?
Well, thank you very much for inviting me for the first time to be on this front. Typically, I'm sitting in the other front enjoying the talks. But today, I'll tell you a direct answer on that. This is just a small fraction of what Africa is going to attract from the $100 billion. Annual contribution to support the Paris Agreement. This is a commitment. You asked Lana about what are the most important outcome. It is now we are seeing that the banking system, the financial system, starting from the World Bank, the African Development Bank, the European Investment Bank, KfW, and many other institutions are really taking it seriously and providing finance for green investments in general to turn the economy into a green economy and support even in aspects, soft aspects, not only projects, but also providing for example, greening the policies, how your future plans would look like in the future. And for Africa, the 10 gigawatt is only a fraction, and it will move very fast, and we are seeing this movement already. And the Secretariat is established, and Egypt was leading that, and now there is a Secretariat, African Development Bank is leading that. It became a matter of time that countries, okay, the question, the bottleneck would be that the countries are not really prepared to develop bankable proposals. So the projects are there, the ideas, but how to get it bankable is a problem. And this is where the intervention of countries, of developed countries, and for also developing countries with some experience in attracting international funding is going to play a major role. So this is one aspect. The other aspect is we are speaking about different portfolios. So we are speaking about different clusters of countries here, where the African continent itself include countries like Egypt, like Algeria, like Morocco, like South Africa. They have already their own plans. Even Morocco, you can find a target of 52% of their electricity mix by renewable energy by 2030. And this is a big target of 50%, 52%. And this was announced in their nationally determined contribution. And in South Africa, we have a lot of plans. But in other African countries, you are finding an accessibility, the rate of population that have access to electricity in some countries is lower than 30%. And here, it would come a matter of, it's a must to have renewable energy, because extending grids over these vast areas would be very expensive. So we are the only solutions. The renewable energy solution, I'm sorry, energy efficiency solution, are the solution to provide life to these countries. And here comes the role of, for example, centers like we have been meeting during the COP as organization, for example, with ICRI. ICRI is the Western African Center for Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency, similar to ICRI, which we were representing North Africa and the Middle East. They were representing West Africa. And we have been approached by South Africa to establish SACRI, South African Center for Renewable Energy, to support this as a regional. And also were approached by the East Africa War Pool to help them to, as Egypt, as with our experience and with the support of GIZ that we started this, and Germany, BMZ and BMU, we started RECRI, the regional center here. And we're asking also to bring, I think I need to stop and then His Excellency.
Yes, so Dr. Fahmy, welcome. Do you want to give your opening remarks, or should we give you a few more minutes to settle down?
I'd rather make a closing remark.
Okay, so we can do that. That works.
I'm sorry, I was playing my... I was in the church. There is a ceremony now because today is 40 days after. So I had to go there. I'm very sorry for not being able to meet with the opening. So,
no problem. Thank you for joining us. Dr. Maggett, please go on.
Okay, so what I'm saying that with our leadership in this important aspect of the renewable energy in the African continent, we are offering not only now we have bridged to the financial side, but we are also offering a lot of expertise in the project development side, on the know-how and so on. And we are transferring this know-how not only on the national level, but also in the regional level. This is one side. We are discussing a lot of things on the things on the margin of the COP. We were on the other international organization side of the of the COP. We were meeting, discussing, for example, food, water, energy nexus, and how this would work together in the upcoming period. And this was a hot topic for all of us, how we would tackle, for example, the issues like solar pumping, using solar energy in the agriculture sector, how we are going to address, for example, solar thermal, solar heating for industrial application, and how we are going to deal, for example, with the distributed generation solutions and our microgrids, and even the evolution toward the smart grids from the early start rather than reinventing the wheel and starting from traditional grids. So having this leapfrog for the countries is really things that were discussed on the margin. And there were many very nice commitment toward for cities, for example, to go for 100% renewable energy. And the energy efficiency track was also very impressive, that we have seen solutions that are bridging between, for example, this is very similar to what happened in the mobile technology now, the marriage between energy and mobile, and how mobile solutions are offering opportunities for remote areas, that for example for billing and for instead of, you know, that we started with the fixed lines and the telephone and so on, but now we are all using mobiles. So the technology is now using renewable energy is similar to using mobiles in the telecommunication sector. And this is what is happening there. So there are many ideas. I'll elaborate more on that, but after all.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Magid. Mahmoud, you're a fierce believer that renewable energy can be very instrumental in effectively reducing greenhouse gas emissions worldwide. So could you please elaborate a little on this and give us some relevant figures as to how instrumental it can be?
Of course, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for the kind invitation. Energy is a key part of the puzzle, definitely. And if we put it in figures, if you look at the emissions, the energy sector is responsible for 2/3 of the emissions worldwide, which automatically makes the energy sector a key priority if we would need to tackle climate change. Of course, here there is a distinction between the energy sector and then electricity generation, because they wouldn't be the same here. And that takes us to the issue of renewable energy as, let's say, the savior in that case. Because so far we've been addressing renewable energy as a solution for electricity generation. So, and that's where the major focus has been. Solutions for heating, solutions for industry. These are different aspects that also need to take a bit more attention. And that's why focusing on renewable energy always comes with energy efficiency as well. So if we consume less energy, that means we're also emitting less greenhouse gases. And I would like to tie that with your opening remark about the NDCs of the different countries. And in an ideal world that all of these NDCs have been honored in the next years, that still won't be enough if we want to limit the temperature rise to less than 2 or 2, which actually means that these goals, these commitments need to be even more ambitious. And not just ambitious, that are also achievable, 100% achievable, if we want to keep the temperature rise under 2 degrees. The transition to renewables, it's already happening. Now more than 20% of electricity generation around the world is actually renewable. We've seen the growth is around 9% per year when it comes to renewable energy and installed capacities. And this it's a question of economics. The prices for electricity generation have dropped dramatically over the last few years. Just some figures when it comes to wind, it has dropped around 60% since 2009. Dr. Magid can correct me. Also, when it comes to PVs, has also dropped massively. And that's why I remember the number yesterday. We were talking about the last auction in Dubai with a number of around $3 or even less. $2.4 for kilowatt hour produced. And this has been a major driver for the growth of renewable energy that we're seeing around the world. A key element for this happening is beyond the economics is also the policies, as has been mentioned before, rightfully so. It's a very important part of the puzzle. And for example, Egypt has been seeing a lot of renewable energy projects starting in the past few years. And a key decisive point was the end of 2014 when we had the feed-in tariff. It opened the door for a lot of different projects we're seeing, especially in the solar, wind is picking up. And of course, the feed-in tariff framework has been revised with a second edition that just came out at the end of 2016. Yes, the transition to renewable energy is happening. Hopefully, it could pick up the speed as well. Africa definitely has a huge potential and a big role to play. And Egypt would be well positioned to take a leading role in that way. And we've already seen it with spreading the RECRE experience around the continent.
Thank you, Mahmoud. Hoda, environmental NGOs and activists are not directly involved in COP negotiations. However, they play a crucial part in creating a momentum and influencing negotiators to be as ambitious as possible. Could you tell us what the role of activists have been in the last two COPs, and what do you think they have managed to achieve?
Thank you, and thank you for having me. So for the role of civil society within the COP, as you mentioned, it is a bit of a challenging landscape for us because we are there as observers. So there's a limited access to how we are able to participate in the negotiations, and we are not given access to the actual negotiating halls or to the negotiating rooms where the core conversation conversations happen, but that doesn't mean that we are, you know, we've come to really grow our voice and our role within the halls of the negotiations. And how we do that is by being able to, we organize actions within the halls, and we are able to then emphasize key messages that help push the negotiations forward. We provide, in doing so, we provide a very important link in what has happening within the negotiations and what the outside world needs to see in terms of climate action, and also in terms of being able to explain to average citizens what the negotiations are about, because they're obviously very technical and very complex. Just to give you a couple of examples in the ways that we have been actively participating and having to play a role in a positive way within the negotiation halls is, during Paris, for example, there was a very crucial moment in the negotiations where island states were leading the process and leading the call within the negotiations to see a more ambitious and stronger language within the Paris Agreement that added to, which was a success, because this is in fact what currently exists in the Paris Agreement in terms of it aspires to 2 degrees as a limit to warming, but it actively calls on governments to seek for more ambitious reductions, right? So the idea is to reach a 1.5 limit. And that was very heavily driven by island states, because to them this is a matter of survival. Just any rise in temperatures means that island nation states are disappearing because of sea level rise. And civil society, basically, we came together, like every single group or every single organization representing civil society that was present at the Paris Agreement took part in a sit-in. And the message of that sit-in was 1.5 and calling for the 1.5 to be part of the agreement. And that obviously had a very positive echo because of the media coverage that came out of that action as well, and we believe it then fed back positively into the negotiations and adding that kind of momentum and seeing those results. Similarly, in Marrakech, we also, as civil society, we came in with a very strong message, and we were basically delivering a letter that was signed by more than 400 civil society organizations from across the world that was building on the findings of a recent report that was published by an international NGO called Oil Change International. And they came to the conclusion, they studied all of the existing oil and gas and coal projects that are currently in operation in the world, and they came to the conclusion that just these projects alone will surpass, the emissions from these projects alone will surpass the limits of 2 degrees. So the urgency is now and today in stopping further developments of fossil fuels if we are going to really enact what the Paris Agreement is about. So we went into Marrakech with that demand and with a letter that was signed by more than 400 organizations. With a very urgent and simple demand of no more fossil fuel developments and the phase out of existing projects to really help the transition that we're already seeing towards renewables, but to really expedite that transition. Because it's simply, the science is very clear in this. There is no other way for us to really avoid the worst scenarios of climate crisis. We're already seeing them. For those of you who don't know, the name of 350.org, which is the group that I work with, this is the number 350 is the safe limit. This is the number of parts per million of carbon dioxide that the atmosphere can currently, should have in order to keep the limits of the Paris Agreement. Right now, we've surpassed 400. So we're already in the red zone. And for us as civil society, it's going into the COP is to continue to emphasize the extent of that urgency and to bring in the voices of impacted and vulnerable communities around the world who are the people who are firsthand living the results of this climate crisis.
Thank you, Hada. Anyone wants to react to what Hada said? Anyone? You're very welcome to, just talk whenever you want, please. Like, okay, then I'm going to move on with a question to Ambassador Well. Could you please quickly highlight Egypt's mitigation and adaptation priorities contained in its roadmap? And could you let us know if you think that Egypt is currently working to raise its ambition in line with the 2 degrees target of the Paris Agreement?
Thank you very much. A quick point on the African Renewable Energy Initiative, because earlier on I said I'd get the opportunity, and I'm going to seize this one, to highlight some of the main trends. Unfortunately for the audience, many of the trends I'm witnessing aren't very positive ones. But the one shining bright spot in Marrakech was all the developments we were privileged to hear and see regarding the field of renewable energy. Africa, and in fact our President Sisi of Egypt, launched this initiative and under his, because President is the head of the Committee of African Heads of State and Government on Climate Change. So within the African continent they are entrusted with that topic to coordinate positions, and Egypt launched under the presidency of President Sisi this initiative, and it is a very, very important and promising initiative. We see it, as do many, many partners within the continent, as much more than just simply a fund to fund projects. It goes well beyond that, and we hope it will have a transformative effect on the entire economy of many countries within the continent. As Mahmoud mentioned earlier, many countries don't even have access to normal grids as we're accustomed to, and this might be the solution for those, but also for countries who are developing and growing. We do have our needs, and to have these needs met by renewable clean energies is something we look forward to, and we are fully committed to working on that front with our African partners to make sure that this initiative is what we hope it can be and what it potentially should be doing to the continent.
Do you mind if I ask an additional question?
Sure.
So before we move on to the rest of the question, basically, No. Just on this initiative, I remember attending a meeting in Zambia of the African Bank of Development in May this year, and basically a lot of the talks were revolving around, well, the next frontier of industrialization is going to be the African continent. So there's this whole push right now to make sure that, you know, the most of the energy that will be part of this development is based on renewable. Could you talk to us a little bit about the whole issues of leapfrogging? Because a lot of heads of states are still think it's a little bit bizarre for developed countries to ask them to not use some of the resources that they have locally, even if they're not the cleanest ones. So just, you know, tell us a little bit more about the frictions that are currently happening.
Sure. I'll try to touch on this as delicately as possible. Of course, the experts from the field here have already mentioned the value of leapfrogging. It's always a good thing. The telecommunications example is a very apt one, and it shows that in some situations you can benefit from these advances in technology. In fact, in the area of renewable energy, it wasn't so attractive, and I'm now trying to link with your question. Why wasn't it such a big deal 10 years ago? Because it was not as economically viable as it has become. It only became important and got the attention and the support from us and many other developing countries when it became a win-win proposition. But when it was quite expensive and out of reach to demand that you should put your development projects on hold, you should not do this, you should not do that, and go clean, was just unrealistic, because there are national demands, priorities, and the foundations of the UNFCCC process was historical responsibility, common but differentiated responsibilities. So these are foundations that we still insist on, because it is very difficult for a policymaker in many countries, and I know that this logic doesn't really find a lot of support in many of the advocacy groups, and I fully respect their entitlement to see it from a purely environmental perspective, but truly, in Egypt and most developing countries, it is extremely difficult to perceive and address environmental issues in complete isolation from the economic and social dimensions. So when a government or a policymaker has pressures coming from all over, the ideal situation is what we call a win-win situation, whereby you can achieve this and at the same time keep the environment clean. This is the threshold, the breaking point where we're at right now, which, again, as I said, this was the brightest point in Marrakech for me. I saw a lot of things that didn't make me very happy, but all the developments, and I wish, as Mahmoud alluded, the negotiations were on your left as you're entering, and all the rows on the right were the interesting people with the projects and the technologies. And whenever I could slip out of the sometimes dull negotiations and cross that passageway, into the more interesting side, I really had a great time. And one of them was when they talked about AREI, and they actually articulated and quantified how this ambition of jumping from 10 gigawatts now to 300 in 2030. A very wonderful, well-informed lady said, these are not just numbers. And she gave us a breakdown of how this ambition is going to be met. Now to your point, and I'm sorry for talking going on this, but yes, we are doing our part. We don't have this animosity towards mitigation projects and saying it's only adaptation, we're suffering, we're the biggest continent that's suffering. That is true, but we are fully committed and convinced of our own interest in espousing mitigation projects and having added ambition with the qualifiers that I just mentioned right now regarding our national growth plans and our other needs and necessities. But in Egypt, of course, we've heard some information about our feed-in tariff. This is a very big deal, and I had the honor and privilege of presenting it in passing in a number of occasions, and I try to be modest and understate the significance, but people told me, don't try to understate it. This is a big deal, what you have just done. You can understand the sensitivity in a country like Egypt when you talk about utilities and private sector. So for those of us who Egyptians who lived through the 60s or 70s and 80s, perhaps, will appreciate that it was not an easy decision to take. So the feed-in tariff was a big deal. The phasing out of our inefficient fossil fuel subsidies, again, a very, very difficult, potentially hazardous political decision to take. But it is a necessity, and it is serving the climate plan and action that we have. LED lighting. And we're grateful to many of our international partners, especially within the UN system. My office, the entire foreign ministry, was part of a pilot project to transform, transfer from your traditional bulbs to the LED bulbs. And I talked with our admin people, and they gave me actual figures that escape me right now about the air conditioning bill and how it went down because of that project, and now it's moving on to various other government buildings. So a lot is being done. You mentioned part of our adaptation, the most significant one is protection of the coastal lines. There's a lot that we have done, and we have the ambition, and the political will, and the commitment is there, but again, I have to qualify it with my earlier statement regarding there are national priorities. We have our already overburdened national budget. We're doing a lot. All of what I mentioned, by the way, is out of the national budget. Yet we are fully committed to moving forward, but we need to have that balance. And again, that might take me back to the trends I talked about in the negotiations.
Well, you just provided me a perfect segue to my next question to Lena, which is actually on climate finance flows. So I was wondering, do you believe that developed countries are showing positive signs that the promised, $100 billion a year will be mobilized by 2020? Also, second part of the question, there has been talk at COP22 to achieve a better balance between mitigation and adaptation in climate finance. So could you explain to us what it means concretely? Also, before you answer, sorry, you can now start writing down your questions on the post-its and someone will pass in a few minutes to get them. Thank you.
Well, thanks a lot for the question. On climate finance, it's of course always a question of how we count climate finance. So the $100 billion goal and providing annually $100 billion came from many years ago already from Cancun. So the aim is in 2020 to provide $100 billion a year to developing countries of climate finance. This is a mix of public and private climate finance, and especially this mix has always been the cause of many discussions and the negotiations of how do you actually count, especially the private finance flows. Public finance, okay, you can go into the national budget and see what the number is, but for private finance, how do you count what is actually climate finance, which projects would count as private finance, so this has been like very contentious issue. In the run-up to Paris, there was numbers published that developed countries were already getting to $60 billion a year, but this number was also contended, so it's always a question of how you count it. But I think the positive signal, at least, has been that in October 2016, so just before the COP in Marrakech, developed countries actually did sit together and asked themselves,
how are we planning to get to the 100 billion? How are we feeling to fill that gap? Like, even if we have, like, if we still fight about how we count it, but let's see that we at least get a plan to scale up climate finance to 100 billion US dollars. And I think publishing this roadmap has been a positive signal to the international negotiations. With respect to the balance of mitigation and adaptation, this has been a very important issue in the climate negotiations as well, in the run-up to Paris, because a big share, a big chunk of the international climate finance has always been going to mitigation, because that was of the priority of developed countries from their perspective. Of course, now that we see that the temperatures have been already rising, we are already at 1 degree on average above pre-industrial levels, and the NDCs are giving hope, but not enough hope. So it's becoming, climate change is becoming more and more real, and also developed countries are now actually recognizing, yes, adaptation needs to become more, like, a more serious topic. It has also a very prominent place in the Paris Agreement, has its own article, has its own global goal on adaptation. And so giving this, like, more balanced approach in where climate finance should go in adaptation and mitigation projects is, like, a key message that should be given to the world now, I think. I also want to highlight one of the prominent global goals of the Paris Agreement, which is the so-called Article 2.1c. Negotiators always love to talk in numbers, which says that all financial flows should become consistent with low carbon and climate resilient development. And I think this article is really key to the success of the Paris Agreement, because we can only achieve the goals of the Paris Agreement of staying well below 2 degree or even 1.5 degree if we look, each single country looks at its financial flows. And this does not only mean climate finance flowing from developed countries to developing countries, but it also means Germany looking at its own financial structures, Egypt looking at its own financial structures. Where do subsidies go? Where do public investment go? Do we invest into the right infrastructure, or do we invest in infrastructure that is still based on fossil fuels? So I think looking at this, like, the more broad picture to what financial flows actually mean is key for the success of the Paris Agreement. Thank you.
Thank you, Lena. Actually, Hoda, I was wondering if you could just clarify the fact that we, when we talk about an increase in temperatures of 2 degrees, mm-hmm. has the limit not to go beyond, we often forget the fact that it's a mean temperature, and, like, some, our region, for example, here in the Middle East, will be likely to have temperature rise that is far beyond that. Could you just please clarify this point?
In the way of how it's calculated?
Well, it's just most of the time when we see the 2 degree target, yeah. there is this idea that, you know,
I will speak. So obviously, there, like you mentioned, there's going to be a difference in the way that things materialize per region. But the when we talk about the aggregate overall rise, so this 1 degree that has already risen from pre-industrial levels, this at the global level has a very serious consequence, because it affects the global environment, like the global systems, right? So the problem that we're already seeing is that these switches that happen because something has disturbed the ecological system and the ecological flows means that the repercussions are things that we can't they're too big to preempt, or too big to actually stop once they come about. So things like we are starting to see these supernatural phenomena because the switches are starting to happen, right? So things like, you know, in the Philippines when there was the super typhoons, the name of super typhoons, this is new because they're coming at a force that is something that has never been seen before and not even measurable according to the normal measurements of what a typhoon is. So that's where the risk is in terms of globally. You're seeing shifts that are happening at a scale that is pretty scary and pretty catastrophic. I also wanted to speak very briefly about something related to finance, because this is also an area of work that, for us, there is, in talking about where the flows of finance are going, I want to share some context about a very, you know, a growing campaign that has already been
it's happening around the world, and it's been launched since 2012. But with Paris, we've seen a very stronger, escalation of what the campaign is about. And this is called, it's called a divestment campaign. And divestment is the opposite of investment. And there have been numerous divestment campaigns in history because the premise of it is that you're withdrawing your investments from industries that represent moral problem for you, right? So, for example, during South Africa, there was divestments from the apartheid regime because there were entities around the world that were taking a stance against the apartheid regime in South Africa. So in 2012, there's been the launch of the fossil fuel divestment campaign. And Oxford University is already calling it the fastest growing divestment campaign in history. Because what we're seeing is basically since the Paris Agreement until last December, so just in the span of this 1 year, it's doubled. And you know, the latest numbers are very important in showcasing how big this campaign is growing worldwide. So right now we're looking at close to 700 institutions worldwide that have committed to divest from fossil fuels. Their cumulative assets managed under these companies adds up to $5 trillion. So we're talking about, you know, the idea is because it's at the end of the day based on the moral urgency of, if it's wrong to wreck the planet, then it's wrong to profit from that wreckage. And you know, and businesses, individuals, foundations, churches, they're all seeing this reality because more and more the climate reality is that, you know, is calling for the urgency of climate action. So more and more people are understanding that from the business perspective, there's the risk of investing in fossil fuels. So the divestment campaign is one that I think is also, you know, speaks important perspective within the process, because it enacts what we are calling states to do, right? We're calling on states to shift these public finances away from what is the source of the emissions that is causing climate change.
Thank you, Hoda. Mahmoud, there are not very good numbers coming out of Egypt in terms of CO2 emissions in the past few years. And this is mostly due to the fact that a lot of the industry is starting to use coal over the past few years. So while on the global scale we're observing a plateauing of CO2 emissions just because China has reduced its emissions over the past few years, Egypt is among 11, you know, other countries with like really spiking trends in terms of CO2 emissions. So do you think that increasing renewable energy in the energy mix could be a potential solution for this? And how ambitious can we be?
Well, I think I will invite also Dr. Fahmy to discuss this question. But from what I've seen is that, first of all, I think these are two different issues. I mean, a factory or the industry that is trying to secure the fuel that is needed for its manufacturing process, that's one dilemma. But on the other side, the growth of renewables, that I would say that's also a separate issue. They do overlap when we see some companies trying to have their own renewable energy sources, either for lighting or is it switching to energy efficiency with the light bulbs, as has actually mentioned in the ministry. But we also have seen a bigger project. We've seen Italgen, which is the generation company for Ital Cemente. They're starting to have their own wind farm as well. So there is direction that is going private sector trying to have more renewable energy in their own personal mix. Another good example is Johanna. They have already commissioned their 1 mega solar energy plant, which was built by Karam Solar. So that's happening in parallel. Excuse me? That's not. So it becomes down to a puzzle of three aspects. It's, of course, economics is a key part of solving it, and then comes the environmental impact, and then of course the impact on society. All three coming together in this trilemma, let's call it like that. Of course, the role of monitor and control when it comes to the different emissions from each factory needs to be a key part here to see the environmental impact of one industry's the production for one industry versus another. Energy efficiency is starting to be rolled out more. in different factories. Personally, we've been seeing our customers asking for better ways to save on their electricity bill, to save on the waste that comes out of the manufacturing processes, and that's going up. What's interesting is going up with the reduce of subsidies when it comes to electricity. More expensive electricity, people start wondering, okay, how can we go down with the bill? So again, back to the economics of the incentives. Again, the growth of renewables, I think we've already mentioned that it's quite an important part of the puzzle. Egypt is definitely on starting on the right path. Yes, feed-in tariffs was a big deal. And also the pressure that we see from the increasing of the electricity prices is also encouraging people to go into renewables. Maybe a key point to discuss here when it comes to, let's say, a potential bottleneck, it's perhaps the whole process that needs to be done, all the approvals that need to be, that the investors need to go through. We discussed that yesterday lengthily. Maybe that's definitely an important area for improvement. Of course, we have the goal of a one shop stop to get everything done, just one window where you can get all the approvals. But I believe that there is, let's say, room for improvement when it comes for all the bureaucracy for projects to launch.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Magid, would you say that Egypt has a robust and comprehensive renewable energy action plan? Because if you look at other Arab countries, Egypt is faring pretty well in terms of deploying renewable energy. But do you think that there is this push and this comprehensive plan that exists with set targets to make it easier to implement actually such objectives?
Okay, this is a sensitive question because, in fact, we, the Egyptian citizens, are great. We are doing fine. And the government is, I think, doing its best right now. And over the past few years also, they are doing their best too, in view of the situation that we were, the transitional period that we were facing. And based on our recent analysis, we are producing annually what is called Arab Future Energy Index. Egypt is the ranked number 3. You were co-author on that, Louisa. Egypt is number 3 after Morocco and Jordan, despite that we are in a transitional period, in attracting investments in renewable energy. We have referred to the first feed-in tariff round and now the second. In the first feed-in tariff round, we attracted more than 136 consortium, not company, applied for this round. And this is on the large scale. For the small scale, amazingly, right now, we have at the new and renewable energy authority more than 200 companies, small companies, registered to install a rooftop system for photovoltaic systems. 200 companies in 2 years. And we have now, although NREA is not announcing that, but I'm announcing it, we have more than, I'm sorry to say it, we have more than 90 megawatt of installed capacity of photovoltaic system. 90 megawatt. NREA is telling 15 and 20. But I have visited companies, and we have been there. And in fact, if you go simply to Ahad Bahreya, you'll find more than 1,000 solar pumping system operational, out of need because of scarcity and difficulty, the availability over the past 2 years of diesel. And they are switching to photovoltaic, and there are companies serving that. And we have seen a very nice program on for the public buildings and rooftop systems for photovoltaic, and we have seen also initiatives for some mosques. And there are activities, but are they consolidated in one action plan? I'm sorry to say, I have never read a comprehensive report saying what is happening in Egypt. I have an idea. I'm trying to compile this within the AFEX because I'm addressing different aspects, distributed generation, utility scale project, larger scale, and so on. Even the rural areas rectification, but they are not consolidated. They are not even coordinated in one pool. We have an excellent entity, one of the oldest in the region, the Egyptian New and Renewable Energy Authority, which is very good authority in terms of capacities and in terms of knowledge available. However, they are not really mandated to coordinate the activities. In fact, we have seen that I'm not asking them, and this is, I have pledged them, in fact, please, please, do not think of yourself as part of the Ministry of Electricity only. Now the title has changed. It's Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energy. So renewable energy is a separate arm. So this arm is electricity, the other arm is renewable energy. And they should not think of having all the control on this domain. But what is happening, the success story that is happening all over the Arab region, this is where I can speak, what I can speak about. The success story that each organization, each entity take the lead in its domain. For example, those who are working in the agriculture sector, they have, I told you the example of solar bombing, this should be led by the Ministry of Irrigation and the Ministry of Industry, and the Ministry of Agriculture. The program for industrial sector for photovoltaic rooftop system and also for solar thermal application. This is taken by Energy Modernization Center, Cleaner Production Center, and the Environmental Compliance Office. They are all providing facilities. So this is taken by the Ministry of Industry. Also the excellent work done by the Ministry of Environment regarding waste to energy and regarding biomass, they have excellent. So they are taking the lead on that. NREIA need just to coordinate and to take this into one comprehensive action plan that Egypt can announce. I think part of our, you say that the numbers are not that much for CO2 emission. Part of this because we are not aware what is happening in Egypt. We are all doing excellent things, individual level, organizational level, but they need to be clustered, grouped together, and reflected in one single document. And with the League of Arab States, we work it. We work under the umbrella of the electricity ministers, Your Excellency. And we have assembly developed 2 years ago a template. We call it Arab Renewable Energy Guideline because we don't have directive like Europe, but this was inspired by the European directive. We have a guideline for renewable energy, which includes a template for how to design a national renewable energy action plan. And this month, Lebanon announced their action plan. Bahrain announced the renewable energy action plan. Sudan is now in the minister's office, the action plan for renewable energy, which have all the actors together in one pool. So I'm saying that we are doing excellent. We have excellent efforts. All the entities are doing excellent job. Just we need to consolidate this in one action. And I think the coming phase of the NDC would have a different shape because our NDC now is including only text with no concrete numbers. But given the fact that we have already excellent achievement, we have seen the Egyptian vision for 2030. And the Egyptian vision target 35% renewable energy share by 2030. And the Ministry of Electricity and Energy, the Energy Strategy of Egypt, which was announced just last September, it has also a similar target of 35% renewable energy. So we have targets, we have numbers, we have activities. Just let's put this together, show what we are doing to the world, and we should be proud of what we are doing, really.
Thank you, Dr. Maged. I have actually one last question. I think we're all really excited to listen to your closing speech, so I'm just going to ask one last question before that, to Hoda, actually. So basically, there's going to be a lot of work that will need to be done in the coming years by civil society to make sure that, you know, policymakers are as ambitious as they should be. So how do you think you can organize regionally, even globally, between different entities to actually make sure to have the most impact possible and to also help them be as ambitious as they can?
I think it's something that we are already seeing happen in many ways. Before the view of environmental issues in general, not just climate change, is that they were a separate issue of their own and addressed in specific conversations or specific policies. More and more, not just within governments, but also within citizens around the world, everyone is seeing more and more the connections between talking about environmental issues, how they relate to social issues, how they relate to economic issues. And I think this is a very important turning point because not only does it inform what you know, what is being demanded of governments and what opportunities governments have to really prove or showcase what climate action looks like, it's also an opportunity for what because we, for example, for us at 350, as because we are actively building a climate movement around the world,
oftentimes people come to us wanting to know how they can engage. They are concerned for their children, for the future generations, and they're wanting to find ways to be able to engage. And this cross-sectionality, this this clarity that all these issues are interrelated, means that people from all walks of life, across all levels of governance, whether it's within their immediate communities or within municipalities or within the government itself, they are able to engage in campaigns and demands and organize in ways that are very, very, action-oriented and very clear in their results. I spoke just now briefly, for example, about the divestment campaign. A big part of why it's mushroomed in the way that it has is because it is a campaign that allows people around the world to take it on themselves. It's not backed up by an institution. It's something that individuals can take on and call their pension funds or their universities or their church or mosque, whatever entity they are associated with, and know that they have investments in fossil fuels. They're able to call on them to withdraw those investments because they are concerned, and their investments in these entities, they no longer want to see that connection with what is a source of climate change.
Well, thank you very much, Hoda, and thank you to all our panelists for being here today. I'm just going to ask you to stay put for a few more minutes while we listen to the Minister of Environment's concluding remarks. Please, sorry.
Your Excellency. So, can I have the mic?
Yes, you can have the mic. Here you go.
Thank you. I have the moderator mic.
Yes.
First of all, thank you very much for the invitation, and I'm very sorry being late, but as said, I had to go to the church for our condolences. Today is 40 years after the criminal attack on the church, so I'm very sorry for that, in addition that the traffic was not the best. Anyway, let's go some points. Let me say one thing, that this is the 45th session of a series of climate talk sessions, which is organized with the support of the German government, and I'd like to extend my thanks and appreciation for all what the German government is doing for us in the field of environment in Egypt, and these are several, and they are expected to grow. So thank you very much, Your Excellency the Ambassador, for your support. In addition, that you support in educating me. So German people did pay for my my PhD. So thank you very much, guys. Anyway, another thing is that when we talk always about on climate change, there is a shift that is notable. First in Marrakech, there is a shift that after Paris, that we are forgetting the basic principles of the convention. Let's forget the convention. Let's forget the principles of the convention. Let's concentrate on the Paris Agreement. Well, the Paris Agreement is a tool to implement the convention with, of course, the very famous principle, common but differentiated responsibility, and the historical responsibility. There is a shift now. There is a trend now. Forget the past, and let's open a new page. And we're not. We're not going to agree with that. And when I say we, it's all the African countries that we were representing in Paris and in Marrakech. So we're going to keep reminding this. And I'd like us to always keep talking on this. Don't let them, raise your memory on this. There are convention principles that we have all signed to, and these principles will be implemented. Otherwise, there will be no implementation of the Paris Agreement. It's very simple as that. So let's not forget this. The other thing, always the discussion moves from climate change into more mitigation. It's all about mitigation. It's what's happening today. Mitigation. Well, we're not the polluters. We're not. So you tell us, how are you going to help us in meeting our problems? So let's not be dragged into discussing things that are important,
But we have more important issues here. It's about the poor. It's how will we feed the hunger? What are we going to do with jobs? These are our priorities in the developing world. Like it or not, that's what it is. On the other hand, when it comes to touching the economic interest of the developing countries, they will fight for their industry and they will fight for their jobs. Why shouldn't we? It is, as always, and as always have been from the beginning of time, poor and rich, strong and weak, but taking different shapes. We had the same discussion in Stockholm in the 70s when we started talking about the environment. The same discussions. India and China, and the same discussions. Sometimes it's old games, but new names. That doesn't mean that we are not committed, Egypt I'm talking now, we are not committed to the Paris Agreement and to the commitment of the Paris Agreement. No, we're not. But we like others to be committed as well. All the agreement, not parts of the agreement. We're not going to be selective here. If we're going to talk about mitigation, we're going to talk about the pre-2020 financial assessment. If we're going to talk about coal, well, we're ready. We're ready to exchange power station fired coal with solar station power coal if you, somebody will give us and help us with the difference in the economic cost. So, and I have discussed this. I'm not the Minister of Electricity, but I have agreed with the Minister of Electricity on this. So, who's going to help? If we're talking about ambition, this is our ambition. That's our ambition. And if we are asked to do that, as the Paris Agreement said, that we will deliver our NDC, we will say, how is the curve of the CO2 emission will grow, when will it reach its peak, and when will it start going back again? That's what we have agreed on. And that's what we're going to put in our NDC. And by the way, Egypt has an NDC. And we have a detailed NDC. And we know our the sector, the emission for each sector has been calculated. We know where we're going. But there is always time to present what we know. And we have to root the chaos down. It's negotiations. Negotiations. So, do we have an NDC? Yes, we do have an NDC. But our NDC is just like the one that Paris told us. Adaptation, mitigation, and means of implementation. The three together. That's our NDC. Coal and if I just may ask, you have mentioned that the numbers of CO2 for Egypt is growing. Which years are you referring to?
2014, 2015. So this is the last record.
It cannot be coal.
Yes, it is.
Can't. Because 2014, we haven't given any permission for coal. There was no coal in the country. The first coal that came into the country was after the law was issued, and this happened in 2015 March. So definitely the numbers 14 is not. But I'll tell you why the CO2 has been, yes, many factors. First, that after a shutdown of most of our industry after the revolution in 2011, it started to pick up again in 13 and 14. One thing. Another thing, we don't have gas. We don't have natural gas. So the industry turned into using mazut and salt. And that increased the CO2. But it could not be coal, because I'm sitting on the coal. I'm the one that's giving the permission to the coal. And we did not give permission to the coal. The second thing, even if you give permission, the cement industry, which has the permission, it's only the cement industry, did not have already built up the facility that it needs to process the coal. Using coal is not, you just don't shut the natural gas and just feed it up with coal. It doesn't happen this way. There is a lot of investment that has to be done. Well, it didn't happen. Only two companies that were working on coal. But the real reason is we do not have natural gas. So our energy sector was not working with natural gas and was using low-grade fuel. Our fuel is characterized by a heavy content of sulfur. So we do have SOX2. I'm telling you more facts. Then we have problem with the SOX, the SOX, the sulfur oxides that we're addressing. So it cannot be coal. But that doesn't mean if you use coal, you will not have more CO2. I'm not saying this. But we still have a period to go. Just like Germany, when they phased out coal now, what, which year? 2050? Huh? No, 50, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Maybe Lena is the best.
No, ma'am. Mrs. Barbara, I mean, the Minister of Environment was just with us. They have extended, and they are using the brown coal for energy sector, and they are modernizing their power station, and they will phase out coal in 2050. 50, ma'am. I just was with her in Marrakech. Guys. Anyway, 30. But that doesn't mean what? Then when there is an economic, when there is an economic pressure, we change, we raise the bar. I think we have the same right. We need energy. We need energy. We need energy for pumping water. We need energy for our consumption. We need energy for our industry. And we have to use all ways and means to get energy. That does not exclude renewable energy. It does not. But we have a mix. We have an energy mix that we have agreed already in the higher Supreme Council for Energy, which puts the coal not more than 15 in the energy mix. At the same time, we'll be raising energy to 30, and 20, and then 30, and then 35. Renewable energy to compensate. At the same time, what are we doing in the cement industry that has to use coal? There is no other way but to use coal in the cement industry. The problem is whether you will increase your mix of RDF and alternative fuel, and how can you do that, and your efficiency in doing that, and that's what we're working on, so that we will increase the portion of the RDF that we deprive from solid waste, and we're doing that. And all the permits that we gave to the companies are only for 2 years, with a condition that they increase the alternative fuel. And they did submit plans for that. And they will not get their permit for importing coal unless they are complying with this plan. And by the way, the committee that's going to look into the renewal and extension of the permit has the civil society on it. And the civil society of where this factory is. So the civil society is there, the industry is there, the regulatory is there, which is the environment, the municipalities are there, and they are the one that says yes or no. And we think this is a very good tool to reach compliance. Why? The industry will put, the cement industry, will put a lot of investment to use coal, and there is no turning back. So if you have, if you're sitting on the coal, because we're importing it, great, great, we can control it. So if they comply with the plan, we will extend. If they don't comply with the plan, we will not renew. The issue is not using coal or not using coal. The issue is how you use coal, how far, when will you phase it out? And what do you do to encourage the renewable energy? So you have to work and go on two legs, not only on one leg. How can I convince the workers, oh, by the way, we're going to shut your factory because you're using coal, because the CO2. And you know, by the way, that your land in the Delta, a part of it could be by the oversea, could be drowned. In spite that you use coal, but because others have done this in the past. Come, try and let's go to the parliament member and try to convince him with that. Let's go. Let's go to the people in the field and try to convince him with that. The German have one way. They do this. Yeah. And I'm not this. So we respect the experience of others, but we will do it our way. We will do it our way, and we ask you for your help and your support. But we will do it our way. And we will do it in taking in consideration the welfare of the Egyptian people. Coal, if you use the clean coal technology, which everybody's using, China, Germany, Poland, there is no serious impact on health. The only problem is the CO2. And we'll follow the general trend in that. But we're using coal and we're going to phase out coal. That's for sure, and we have the energy mix for that. And we're using all economic, all policy means. We're going to be going soon to auction. We have to go to auction. We're going to be soon. We're putting the feed-in tariff for solid waste, for waste to energy. We did it. And it's been approved by the Prime Minister and by the Cabinet. And just because that there was the devaluation, that we are now fixing the new number. And the new number we know. So that we attract investor to go into this waste energy business. And we have already. We have four companies that we sign on that are working in the Delta for waste to energy. So we have. Why waste? Our waste produces a lot of methane. 1 to 26. So one low-hanging fruit for our NDC is to go for waste. Definitely. Definitely. And I'll decrease the CO2. And then go for renewable. And then go for public transportation. Would our NDC be implementable? That's one question that you, the young guys, should ask us. Is it implementable or just only a plan? That it is. Why? Why? For one good reason. We didn't start dreaming. We went to the 5-year plan and got the projects that are already financed. And they are the ones that are in the NDC. So from the beginning, we made always the mistake that we had a different environmental action plan. You don't do it this way. You go and include your environmental programs into the different sectors program. So into the 5-year plan that's already financed. It will be implemented. But if you have it aside, it's not. We did this a lot, yeah. So anyway, I'm not saying everything is perfect, and I'm not saying we're living in heaven, and I'm not saying that. But do we know where we're going? Yes, sir, we know what we're going. Do we have plans? Yes, ma'am, we already have the plans. Can we implement them? Yes. But we would like the obligations of the developed countries to help us in that. And let's not forget this. If they care for jobs, we care for jobs too. Another thing is, we went to Marrakech, and it should have been an implementation COP. Well, it has been a postponement COP. We were postponing things because one big nation has changed, and we have to wait. The things that happened yesterday and the day before are alarming. And they are not Egypt. They have the know-how. And they have the resources. Would they prefer the jobs? Would they prefer economic thing? Let's wait and see. I hope they don't. And I hope that we all stick to the Paris Agreement. And I hope that we implement the spirit of Paris Agreement. And not go back to the negotiation table on things that we have already. Once they tell you public money, and then they tell you public money, but most of it is private money. You go to the private sector, they tell you who's going to pay for the patient and for the patent and all this stuff. Then you don't have the money. So, I mean, if you go into the public money, they will put this as part of the development project that already exists. So you don't know which is which. Is this an additional fund or is this the same fund? I mean, these tricks, we all play. Aware. So there is a lot of things, and everybody's defending his interest. Everybody's defending his interest. No problem. But we all have one interest, that we keep this world alive. And we're ready to take our share. But everybody should take his fair share. No shifting of costs from the rich to the poor. This is not fair. That's our policy. Thank you very much. I can take one or two questions if you allow me. Yes.
We'll take two questions.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. I wish to see that the Ministry of Environment would have one great role of banning all the cars that produce massive deleterious exhaust. I think my voice is loud enough,
so I
can rephrase it. That is, I wish if there is a single goal for the Ministry of Environment, to eliminate all the cars that are just destroying our health, this massive exhaust from all those cars. It's a simple thing. I don't know why it's not done.
I share your wish is that I have one goal. Because it makes my life very easy. Easier than the suffering that we are in. But unfortunately, our environment has a lot of problems. It's not only the cars. And by the way, there was a black cloud couple of days ago in Paris and London. They stopped the cars. They stopped the, they use the odd numbers and they stopped there.
Let's do that.
Let's do one thing. Because we have such a plan. We have a plan in the draw of using the electric cars, electric buses, and how to manufacturing here, and what are the policy reforms that are needed. I'm not going to stop the car. I'm going to stop the back cars. Okay? But there is a price to pay. There is a price to pay. And we have to be willing to accept the price. It's not a good moment politically to do that. Yes, the Minister of Environment is a technical ministry, but the minister should be a political one. I mean, I'm a politician at the end. So yes, sir. Yes, we have this. Okay. And it will come out in the proper time. When our economic in 1 year, but these studies are there, guys, with the precautions and what to do in emergency, you will find soon very transparent information on the air pollution situation. You will have it screened in Tahrir, and you will have it in Cairo University, and we'll expand in this. It's going to be on our site. We will not hide any information. It's not going to happen. as long as I'm there, and the ministry will continue because we have built the system. We have now an early warning system nationwide for the first time. I didn't declare this until now. I don't like to declare things unless they are finished, they are ready. They will be ready within a month. And we will have a nationwide alarming system that tells you exactly how the environment, especially the air, nationwide. We're working on this. Egypt is standing again on its feet. And rest assured that we will do everything needed for that. Sir, you, yes.
Okay, this is the last question because we have to close after that. No, I said two, I'm sorry.
How can ministry help student or graduate student to help country in small project to use renewable energy and to help in its sustainable development and found their thanks?
Look, we're not in terms of budget. Even in terms of staff, we're not a big ministry, but what we are doing is we're working with the social fund, and we have done this 2 years ago, where we have provided credit line with 20% grant that we pay, so that young people can buy big machines where that they can address the agriculture. It was working. It's working in Sharqiya very well. And this year, I think you have noticed that we didn't have the black cloud with the normal background. It's because that we have changed our policies. I agree with you fully that we have to do these credit lines so that young people will be able to use. We're doing it for we're extending it now for the solid waste management within the Alexandria. The new contract for Alexandria. We're working on now on the Cairo governorate new contract, a new solid waste management where we put all these things. So yes, but we have to work with others on this as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister, for those very comprehensive closing remarks. I'm sure a lot of you still have questions, but what I think we should do at this point is take it to the garden and you will be able to discuss in more details whatever questions you have with our panelists. So thank you so much for being here tonight. And thank you again to our panelists, the ambassador and the minister. Thank you.